paradise and come Monday and changes in attitudes, changes in latitudes. I got that reversed. Changes in latitudes, changes in attitudes. And Margaritaville, the immortal Margaritaville. Where the hell is Margaritaville? There's my first question, okay, my first hard-hitting question. Where is Margaritaville, Jimmy?
Oh, it's a late-night place, Bob. It is. It's in your mind. That's what it is. It's funny, there have been many attempts to make it into a movie, but I sort of left it mythological. If we miss it, we miss it big.
Is there any place on the map that was sort of the inspiration for it?
I tell you, I started thinking about it when I wrote the book of short stories. When I wrote the song, it was a matter of 5 minutes. It was a great margarita on a hot day in Austin, Texas. I went back to Key West, and it was the first, that was 1977, first big influx of tourism that the town had seen. So it was a good, it was a good observation point. I actually wrote some verses that were, that I cut out of the original one because it's a little too close to home.
Like?
Old men in tank tops, cruising the gift shops, checking out Chiquitas down by the shore. They dream about weight loss, wish they could to be their own boss. Three-day vacations become such a bore.
That's good.
Yeah, but in those days, they, actually they cut it for time. Went to be a single. Of course, I didn't care then, so
I just typical record company move.
Oh, yeah. Cut it for time. Make it go into 3 minutes. But in those days, I had no power, so I had to go, okay, now I would never let him cut it.
You were kind of scuffling along for a while,
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah. I had a real drop in the bucket career. There was not much happening. I went to Nashville, left there, and went to Florida. Found Key West at a great time, you know. I actually got there by mistake. I had booked a gig in Miami, and I booked myself then, and I arrived 2 weeks too early. And I went, oh. Or else the...
A small mistake.
Or else the club owner lied to me. Now, of course, I believe it was the club owner's fault. But anyway, I wound up stranded in Miami. I went to Key West. It was November, and it was just wonderful, you know. And the only thing that I knew about Key West was to have or have not. You know, I'd read the book. And then it literally looked like it. In those days, and I said, boy, I'm gonna stay here. And it was a great place. I think that, and then, of course, the history of Key West with all the writers who've been there. Writers are sort of crazy people anyway, they need a lot of room, and Key West was a very, very tolerable town, and has been.
You know, I guess most people know you as a recording artist, but more and more people are getting to know you as an author. Now, as we tape this, this little bit of business is number 5 on the New York Times bestseller list, but I've got advance word that it's heading up maybe as high as number 1, and this is your first novel, the earlier one, Tales from Margaritaville, collection of short stories. Where is Joe Merchant? Now, this has to be heady stuff. First novel out of the box, and it's climbing to the top of the New York Times list.
I think my third grade teachers, the Sisters of Mercy, would be very proud of me. Because I was not one to deliver term papers. Ultimatums were needed to get me to write. But it's, you know, it really has always been in there. Writing was really my first love as a kid. And music I basically stumbled into. So the desire to write was always there because I was a reader. My mother was very instrumental in me reading a lot when I was a kid. And so I loved stories from my family who were all seafaring people. So there's a lot of imagination going on within my family. And so writing was something I really wanted to do, and music sort of came along, and I did it. But that desire was always there, so when I had time, I wanted to go back and do a book.
You do have a colorful background. Your parents, your grandparents, right?
Yeah. My grandfather was a sailing ship captain from Nova Scotia, and subsequently aunts and uncles and all were either, you know, they either ran boarding houses for sailors or they were sailors. So I grew up in a small town in South Alabama and around Mobile. And so when everybody else was in sort of their southern hamlet existence, I had all these inputs from around the world. My grandfather would bring back things for all the grandchildren and stories as well to boot. So I had this great view of a bigger world in a place that didn't have such a big view of the world. I saw this as a kid, so, and New Orleans was the town where all the ships came in, so a lot of our family lived in New Orleans, and that was the big city I traveled to as a kid, and that's where, you know, and there was a very bohemian existence in the French Quarter. This is pre-hippie days, and I'd see that, and I had aunts and uncles who lived there, so it excited me, and it looked a lot better than going to work in a shipyard back in Mobile, you know?
Yeah. What would you liken, or how would you liken your style to somebody whose name we would recognize in terms of your writing style?
I'll tell you who were influences in when I started to write this book. It's sort of like when I started writing songs. You had people who were your heroes and songwriters or artists to me. Gordon Lightfoot, Joni Mitchell, Josh White. I was a folkie. I can use the F word. I was a folk singer. And I think most of us still are. So these people were, you know, very catalytic to your writing process, and you'd hear a record and make you write. So when I went to write books, I said, well, I got to go back to the books that really got me excited. And they were certainly the John McDonald books, Travis McGee. Mm-hmm. I miss Travis McGee a lot. And Ellen Gilchrist. And I really like short stories. And there were some great old books of poetry. So I'd go back and look at those just to get a feel of something on how to begin and end. The short stories were written basically, I had a sense of them because I had songs of the same title. So I had basic story beginnings. The book that I started from scratch. So the only way that I had to pace it was by looking at books that I like to read to see a pace in a book. You know, I didn't want it to be too long, didn't want it to be too short. That's the way I like to do my shows, and I found myself going back. The only real barometer by which I could judge was how I pace a live show, how I sequence a record. So I gave all the chapters title names like I would a record so that I knew where I was.
Yeah, like Suntans and Percodans and I'll Be Your Pizza Tonight.
I'll Be Your Pizza Tonight is my favorite chapter. But it is. Plus, I love titles. If you got a great title, you got a great song.
So even though you grew up reading Hemingway and Faulkner and Fitzgerald and Treasure Island, so Robert Louis Stevenson is in there, and then, like all of us, Mark Twain, and in everything I've read about you, you cite all these things as inspirations, if not influences. Mm-hmm. You're not aiming for any sort of deep meaning. This is a lot like your musical persona. Let's entertain, let's amuse, let's make it breezy, and if you find any meaning beyond that, great, but it ain't my first intention.
There's lots of serious people in this world. I think the problem with the world is that a lot of people that are too serious. Humor is an essential part of our existence, I think. So I certainly have ideas and things that I convey in there. I mean, in the book, there certainly are points that I put out, but I do it very satirically through the characters. And I like to do that instead of beating people over the head with it. I was always a great admirer of all great satire writers, and I think that's the way, for me, it fits. And again, it's just not that serious. I've had a great time doing what I do. I never started out to do it, but I worked very hard at it. So it wasn't something that you know, the music business today is sort of a conglomerate, you know, run by corporations who are looking for retail profits. I got in for the passion of the music and never thought about the money. I got in it because it looked like the coolest job to have.
Where it all ends, I can't fathom, my friends. If I knew, I might toss out my anchor. So I cruise along, always searching for songs. Not a lawyer, a thief, or a banker. But it's son of a son, son of a son, son of a son of a sailor. Son of a gun, load the last ton. One step ahead of the jailer. I'm just the son of a son, son of a son, son of a son of a sailor. The sea's in my veins, my tradition remains. I'm just glad I don't live in a trailer.